in general, our book abrogated all the books before. This kitab is muhaiminan alayh. It's a book that abrogates all the books before. Lakin, if our Quran comes and affirms a ruling that Yahud affirmed, we take it. Not because it's in their book, but because our Prophet said alayhi salatu wasalam. Same to Injil. Something the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, like for instance, Allah says in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ. They used to fast, so do we fast. So something they did and something we did. We are common in fasting. Even the method is different, like in we all fast. We believe that fasting is compulsory upon us as it was compulsory upon them. Who told us that? Allah Azza wa Jal. Okay, what about the things our religion tells us not to act upon it from their religion? The things that their religion needs to do that our religion is not allowed. For instance, Nabiullah Adam alayhi salam, when Allah ordered, I mean Nabiullah Yusuf for instance as well, when Allah ordered, when all his children prostrated for him, his brothers, sorry, and his father and his son, his mother, they all done sujood for him. Are we allowed to do sujood for anyone? لا. But their religion was allowed. Can we do it? لا منعت لنا ديننا. Our religion prohibited it from us. We can't do that. Okay, now we understand. Things that our religion says we can't do, and their religion allowed us, we take our religion. Because our religion abrogated their religion. And the thing that's in their religion, and our religion affirms it and says, yes, do it. We'll do it because our religion told us. The khilaf amongst the scholars now is, what about the things that their books did not say? Sorry, their books say, it doesn't go against our religion, lakin. There's no place it goes against our religion. And it's in their books. Are we allowed to take it from them? The ulama of two qawl. Some of the ulama say, no, we can't take it because our religion abrogated. Why are we going to take their books? And they use the evidence when Musa, Nabiullah, Umar ibn Khattab, he was reading Tawrat. The Prophet saw him. He said, مَا هَذِهِ تَقْرَأُونَهُ يَبْنَ خَطَّاب. What's this you read, Umar? And he said, Tawrat, Ya Rasulullah. I'm reading Tawrat. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he told him to throw it away and not to read it. He said, Wallahi لو كان موسى حي. If Musa was alive, ما وسعه إلا أن يتبعني. If Musa was alive, there would be no other path for him except to follow me. Why would you read his book? Why do you need to read his books? So the scholars that said we are not allowed to take anything from their religion, we're talking about the aspects that our religion does not negate. And it doesn't affirm. ولا معارضة له في نصوصنا. And there's no, it doesn't go against anywhere in our religion. As khilaf. Some of the scholars, they say, لا, we can take it. What's their دليل? The Prophet ﷺ, he said, حدثوا عن بني إسرائيل ولا حرج. Tell the people about بني إسرائيل and there's no problem. Do it. Let them know about it. And he said, in another narration, he said, إن في قصص بني إسرائيل عجب. In the stories of بني إسرائيل is fascination. And so forth. So the khilaf amongst the scholars, قائمة. I can't do tarjih. I can't say this is stronger than this strong because they're both strong to me. So tarjih بغير مرجح تسمى التحكم. I can't say this is stronger than this view as I can't see any strongness in it. So the point is, our Quran muhaimin. It abrogates all the religion that came from before. But we believe in the books. We believe in their books. Ikhwani, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave a big importance for us to believe the books that came before. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He praised His messengers to conveying the books He sent upon them. Allah praised all the prophets by fulfilling this job of conveying the books that they were given. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, الَّذِينَ يُبَلِّغُونَ رِسَالَاتِ اللَّهِ وَيَخْشَوْنَهُ وَلَا يَخْشَوْنَ أَحَدًا إِلَّا اللَّهِ الَّذِينَ those prophets, among those, يُبَلِّغُونَ that are conveying رِسَالَاتِ اللَّهِ Allah's messengers. And they are the prophets and the messengers. The books they were given. So they conveyed a message. If this was something Allah praised them with, then there's no doubt that something they've been praised with is something we have to believe. Something we have to believe. And this is one of the أهميةُ الإيمان بالكتب. أهميةُ الثانية is المؤمنون, the believers, the true believers, آمنوا بما أنزل من عند الله من الكتب. that the real believers, the true believers, they believe in the books that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent. The people of Iman do believe in it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, آمَنَ الرَّسُولُ, that the messengers have believed, بِمَا أُنزِلَ, that which has been sent, إِلَيْهِ, upon them. Each prophet has been given to him. مِن رَبِّهِ, from his Lord. وَالْمُؤْمِنُونَ, and the believers. كُلٌ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ, they believe in Allah. وَمَلَائِكَتِهِ, his messengers, his angels. وَكُتُبِهِ, his books. وَرُسُلِهِ, and his messengers. انظروا عباد الله. This is a characteristic Allah mentioned about the believers. So this is something we have to come with in order to be from those people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the believers to believe in these books, in the Quran. He tabarak wa ta'ala, he said, قولوا, say, آمنا, we believe. بالله, we believe in Allah. وماش, and the thing, أنزل, that has been sent, إلينا, to us, brought our way. وما أنزل إلى إبراهيم, and that which has been sent to Ibrahim. We believe. وإسماعيل وإسحاق ويعقوب والأصباط وما أوتي موسى وعيسى وما أوتي النبيون من ربي لا نفرق بين أحد من رسله. That we believe all of those prophets, what have been sent to them, we believe each and every one of them. Allah has ordered the mu'mineen to say this, that they have iman of it. The second last point to show that the importance of having iman of this is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he destroyed a nation, a people, because of not believing in this. قال تعالى فتولى عنهم, their prophets turned away from them. وقال, he then said to them, يا قومي, my people, لقد أبلغتكم, I have conveyed to you, رسالة ربي, my Lord's message, ونصحت لكم, and I gave you an advice, ولكن لا تحبون الناصحين, you do not love those who give sincere advices to you. The advice that he gave was conveying the kitab that Allah gave him to them. الدين النصيحة قلنا لمن قال لله ولكتابه ولرسوله ولأئمة المسلمين وعامتهم. As it's going to come to us in the kitab, inshallah itself. إذن نصيحة بالكتاب, which inshallah will come through. They gave advice through believing this book. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us, anyone who says, I believe in the Quran, yes. I believe in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, yes. I believe in the religion that's been given to Musa. I believe in the religion that's been given to Ibrahim, wa Isa, all of the prophets, except Nuh, I don't believe it. Kafirun billahi al-ali al-azim. He doesn't believe in Allah, and he has no religion. He says, I believe all the books, but I don't believe the book of Musa. I don't believe Torah. I believe in Jil, I believe Zabur, I believe the Quran, but I don't believe the book given to Dawood alayhi salam. I don't. We'll say to him, that person is a kafir. بِنَصِّ قَوْلِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى, Allah says, وَمَنْ يَكْفُرُ بِاللَّهِ, anyone who disbelieves in Allah, وَمَلَائِكَتِهِ, his angels, وَكُتُبِهِ, and his books, وَرُسُلِهِ, and his messengers, وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ, and the day of judgment, فَقَدْ ضَلَّ, he has become misguided. ضَلَالًا, a misguidance, بَعِيدًا, that is far. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah said, Allah will not say to a believer, فَقَدْ ضَلَّ ضَلَالًا بَعِيدًا, except is a characteristic of the non-believers. You can say the Muslim, Dalla, na'am, ba'idan, to Dalal ibn al-Qitaymi says it doesn't go together. Faqad Dalla, Dalalan, ba'idan. Ikhwani, there are things that the our Quran and the books that came before are common in. Eight things only. Eight things that the books that came before and our Quran is common in. Awalan, وحد المصدر. They all came from one source. All those books, they came from one source. Who is it? Allah Azza wa Jalla. قال تعالى, Allah says, ألف لام ميم, الله أعلم بمرادي. الله لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم, نزل عليك الكتاب بالحق مصدقا لما بين يديه وأنزل التوراة والإنجيل. Allah sent التوراة. Beginning, what did he say? نَزَّلَ عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ. Ay Muhammad, I was the one who sent this Qur'an on you. So Allah sent the Qur'an. وَالتَّوْرَاتَ, Allah sent Tawrat. What did he say? وَأَنْزَلَ وَهُ الْعَطْفِ, and also I sent التَّوْرَاتَ وَالْإِنْجِيلِ, I sent it. مِنْ قَبْلُ, before the Qur'an. هُدًا, guidance. All these books were guidance. لِلنَّاسِ, to the people. وأنزل الفرقان. Allah also sent the Furqan, this kitab that we have. So who sent all the books before? Allah. So it's something that all coming in. They all came from Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. Doesn't mean Torah came from another person, Injil came from, nah. They all came from Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. The difference between us and theirs is the Quran, Allah promised to protect it. إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. We are the ones who sent the Quran and we are the ones that are going to protect it. The Quran, Allah promised that He's going to protect it. As for the other books, بِمَسْتُحْفِظُوا مِنْ كِتَابِ اللَّهِ. They were meant to look after their books. Allah made them look after their books. Did they look after it? لَا يُحَرِّفُونَ الْكَلِمَةِ عَمَّ مَوَاضِعِهِ. They started to change and distort the meaning. But us, Allah promised. كَفَلَ اللَّهُ تَبَارَكَ وَتَعَالَى بِحِفْظِ هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ. Allah took the responsibility of looking after this Qur'an. The second thing is that the Qur'an is common with is وُحْدَةُ الْغَايَةِ. Meaning the Qur'an has the same goal as all the books before. Which was, the غَايَة was أَن تَدْعُ النَّاسَ إِلَىٰ أَن يَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِكَ لَهُ. All the religions before, when they came, they were all, their books were all calling to the same goal, which was to call to Allah alone and not to associate Him with anything. وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا أَنْ اِعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَجَتَنِبُ الطَّاغُوتِ. That's what all prophets were calling to. The ghaya was the same. All these prophets, the religions. Number three, مَسَائِلُ الْعَقِيدَةِ was the same. They all called to مَسَائِلُ الْعَقِيدَةِ. Which is, what do I mean by that? They all call to that there's going to be a day of resurrection. They all call to that there's going to be a day where they're going to stand in front of Allah. The Prophet ﷺ said in a hadith, مَا مِن نَبِيٍّ قَبْلِي. There was no prophet before me. إِلَّا حَذَّرَ أُمَّتَهُ. He warned his people, مِنَ الْمَسِيحِ الدَّجَّالِ. He warned his people from Dajjal. Every prophet did. And I'm also doing that. مسائل دجال is مسائل عقيدة. So all those prophets called their people from issues of aqidah, which they're aamin. Number four, قواعد العامة. قواعد العامة, which means all the prophets before, they called to the same principle. Which is, what was the principle? If you do good, you will be rewarded. If you do evil, you will be punished. That's all the prophets, what they were saying. Anyone who does something evil will be held account for it. قال تعالى, أم لم ينبأ بما في صحف موسى وإبراهيم الذي وفى ألا تزر وازرة وزر أخرى. This is Ibrahim عليه السلام. That nobody will be held account for another person's mistake. وأن ليس للإنسان إلا ما سعى. And everyone is going to be rewarded to what he strived for. So all the prophets are calling to قواعد عامة. هيا. وأن سعيه سوف يرى. And the thing that he strived for, the day of judgment he will see. ثم يجزاه. That person will be rewarded الجزاء الأوفى, the best of rewards. إذن القواعد, the rewards, all the prophets were saying, do good, you will be rewarded. You do something evil, you'll be punished. إذن their principles were the same. All the prophets called to العدل والقسط, just and fairness. Every prophet was calling to just and fairness. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, لقد أرسلنا رسلنا بالبينات وأنزلنا معهم الكتاب. We sent our prophets with clear evidence, with books. وأنزلنا معهم, and we sent with them الكتاب, the book, والميزان, and a scale. ليقوم, so they can stand for the people with it, بالقسط, with just. All the prophets will say to the people, be just. And they were just in their ways of doing things. They were just. Six, all the prophets were common in محاربة الفساد والانحراف. They all fought against diversion and taking corrupted paths. All the prophets were warning from that. And they were telling their people, if they go against the correct path, that those consequences will not be good. By killing one another, by doing harmful things to one another. Also, الدعوة إلى مكارم الأخلاق. All the prophets were calling to people to have good etiquette and conduct. Musa عليه السلام, The people of Banu Israel, they said he has an illness. They said he has a type of illness. Why? Because he was shy. When they used to dress in front of each other, take their clothes off, huh? And used to have a bath together in somewhere where everyone can see, Musa alayhi salam will not do that. He will go behind somewhere and do his bath by himself. So they said, there's a reason why he's hiding himself. He's got an illness. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he wanted to bring Musa out of the claims that they were putting towards him and show them that he wasn't. So one day he wanted to have a bath. He put his clothes on top of a stone and then started to have a bath. The stone ran and ran with his clothes. Musa started to yell. He said, Hajarun thawbi, Hajarun thawbi, stone, you got my clothes. Today, walil asaf al-shadid, you go to these swimming places where these little kids are taken to and they see these things. Shyness is being taken from them at a very young age. When the school is, this primary school is taking them to swimming, they see people who are not wearing clothes. Your kid at the age of 15 has no haya, has no shyness. إِذَا لَمْ تَسْتَحِي فَاسْنَعْ مَا شِئْتَ. If the person is not shy, he will not do everything. So Musa, he ran after the stone, and then it stopped in the presence of all the people that used to say things about him. Musa took his clothes, got his stick, and whacked the stone until they went. It made a graph on it. He made this, and he took his clothes, and they looked at him, and they realized that the illness that they were saying he had, he did not have. So all the prophets were calling to haya, makarim al-akhlaq, good etiquette, good code of conduct. All the prophets were like that. Number eight, كَثِيرٌ مِنَ الْعِبَادَاتِ. They were calling to the people to worship Allah a lot. وَأَوْحَيْنَا, Allah says, إِلَيْهِمْ, to the prophets, فِعْلَ الْخَيْرَاتِ, to do all the good. The ibadat, all the prophets, to do the ibadat. وَإِقَامِ الصَّلَاةِ وَإِيْتَاءِ الزَّكَاةِ. All the prophets were told to establish the salah. وَكَانَ يَأْمُرُ أَهْلَهُ بِالصَّلَاةِ وَالزَّكَاةِ. وَكَانَ يَأْمُرُ أَهْلَهُ بِالصَّلَاةِ. He used to order his people the salah and to pay Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala his zakat. These are the prophets. So they used to do all of this. This is common. All the prophets called on this. Fasting. All the religions before had it. We also have it. Number eight, which was the last thing. This is what all the books before were common with us in. 8 points. And they have two khilaf with us. Issues of khilaf. Kayfiyatul ibadat. The method of ibadah. They might have the fasting with us, but their method was different. And the second one is al-umurul muharrama. The things that were halal and haram for them was different to what we have sometimes. There were things that were halal for them, that was haram for us. And there were things that haram for us and that's halal for them. These are the two things that it comes back to, all of it. And under that falls many aspects. I thought to myself, because we're talking about al-imanu bil-kitab, I wanted to talk about manzilatul qur'ani, makanul qur'an, the status of our qur'an, the position of our qur'an. Ikhwani, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَاكَ سَبْعًا مِنَ الْمَثَانِ. O Muhammad, we gave you the seven that repeats itself. Surah Al-Fatiha. وَالْقُرْآنِ الْعَظِيمِ. بَعْضُ الْمُفَصِّلِ also said, وَهِيَ Surah Al-Fatiha أيضًا. And some say, like, it's the other surahs in the Qur'an. Allah is saying to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, O Muhammad, I gave you the seven that repeats itself. And I gave you the Qur'an al-Azim. Once I have given you this, and you have this, لا تمدن عينيك. Do not open your eyes to the glister and these shining things of these worldly matters. Why would you? You have the Quran. Allah has given you the Quran. You have it. Why would you then look at the worldly stars and these things that are bright? Because إعطاء الدنيوي لا علاقة له بالرضا بالرضا الله تبارك وتعالى وسخطه. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you something in this dunya does not show that Allah loves you or He cares for you or He wants good for you or He's angry with you. This world does not show anything. Allah says in the Quran, وَلَوْلَا أَن يَكُونَ النَّاسُ أُمَّةً وَاحِدَةً لَجَعَلْنَا لِمَنْ يَكْفُرُ بِالرَّحْمَنِ لِبُيُوتِهِمْ سُخُفًا مِنْ فِضَّةٍ وَمَعَارِجَ عَلَيْهَا يَظْهَرُونَ وَلِبُيُوتِهِمْ أَبْوَابًا وَسُرُرًا عَلَيْهَا يَتَّكِئُونَ وَزُخْرُفًا وَإِنْ كُلُّ ذَلِكَ لَمَّا مَتَاعُ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. This dunya, Allah will give it to a kafir. He will enjoy himself. In this dunya, I have building skyscrapers. He will have kids every year, and a Muslim is looking for children every year. Allah will give him houses. He wakes up in the morning, he's got 10 cars to choose from, which one he wants to drive. And a Muslim is suffering in one place in the world. So giving in this dunya does not have indication that Allah loves this person and he doesn't love this person. Or Allah hates you if he takes the dunya from you. لكن الإعطاء الأخروي. The hereafter, if Allah gives you something, وعلاقة بحب الله تبارك وتعالى لك. It's because Allah loves you. And he wants the best for you. If he gives you something in the hereafter, you've gained Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's pleasement. And that's what Allah wanted to teach the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You have something bigger than anyone can achieve, which is the Qur'an. قال تعالى, Allah says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَتْلُونَ كِتَابَ اللَّهِ وَأَقَامَ الصَّلَاةِ وَأَنفَقُوا مِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ سِرًّا وَعَلَانِيَةً. The ones who recite this Qur'an, and they give for the sake of Allah, and they establish their daily prayers, and they pay the zakat, all of these things. Huh? And read it, the Qur'an. They are in a trading with Allah. تجارة يرجون تجارة لن تبور. A trading with Allah, inshallah, that trading will never lose out. You will never become bankrupt. Why are you going to be bankrupt? You have the kitab of Allah in your hand. You've established a salah. You pay the zakat. You do the good that Allah has ordered you to stay from the evil. Allah is telling our Prophet, don't think of this world as a joy. And inshallah, this is what I want to emphasize on. Allah praised and spoke good about His Quran and His Kitab. Before I mention that, what is the definition of the Quran? ما هو تعريف القرآن? What's the تعريف of the Quran? This is what the scholars they say. كلام الله المنزل. The Quran first is the speech of Allah. المنزل, that has been sent from Allah. The Quran is the speech of Allah. وإن أحد من المشركين استجارك. If one of the non-believers take you and they want something from you, they go become your close. Hey, and they help ask you for your help. Yeah? فاستجاره. Bring him close to you. Lakin with one condition. For him to hear what? حتى يسمع كلام الله. To make him hear the words of Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah says, كلام الله. His speech. كلام الله تبارك وتعالى. ولذلك, it's الكلام الله المنزل. على من؟ على نبي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. المعجز بلفظه. المتعبد بتلاوته. المكتوب في المصاحف. المنقول بالتواتر. لا هو تعريف القرآن. هو أحسن التعريفات. It's the best definition for the Quran. Allah سبحانه تبارك وتعالى, when he spoke about his Quran, I'm going to mention four points that Allah سبحانه وتعالى, the words that he mentioned about his Quran. He referred to his Quran to being عظيم, something big. قال تعالى, وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَاكَ سَبْعًا مِنَ الْمَثَانِي وَالْقُرْآنِ الْعَظِيمِ. O Muhammad, we have given you the seven that repeats itself. And the big Quran. Allah spoke about His Quran as إح. That is حكيم, حكمة. لأنه منبع كل حكمة وفضيلة. It is where all good comes out from. قال تعالى, Allah says, ألف لام راء كتاب أحكمت آياته ثم فصلت من لدن حكيم خبير. The Quran is حكمة, is full of wisdom. Anyone who wants to look for wisdom, it's enough for him to look for in the Quran. ووصفه الله تبارك وتعالى, that is the abrogator, the finalizer of all books. قال تعالى, وأنزلنا إليك الكتاب بالحق مصدقا لما بين يديه من الكتاب ومهيمنا عليه. O Muhammad, we have sent upon you the kitab بالحق. حال, this book is حق. It's a true book. مصدقا, that believes لما بين يديه, that which is from Torah and Injil. من الكتاب ومهيمنا, and also abrogates it. It's the final edition. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentioned His kitab to be Ali, high. And also again mentioned it to be hakim, wise. قال تعالى وإنه في أم الكتاب لدينا لعلي حكيم. علي عالم في منزلته ومكانته. It's high in its level and its rank. And inshallah we're going to come to see. It also even takes the person who memorizes it high. The person who memorizes it is not like the rest of the people. He also gets through lifted it, inshallah. The Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala referred to it as to be mustaqim. It's straight. لا إعوجاج فيه. It's not diverted or anything. It's straight. قال تعالى الله سبحانه وتعالى يسيد الحمد لله الذي أنزل على عبدي الكتاب ولم يجعل له عوجا. That is the kitab Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent upon you, O Muhammad. وَلَمْ يَجْعَلْ And he's not made this kitab. لَهُ in it for you. عِوَجًا a diversion. الإمام ابن فارس in his معجم غايس اللغة he says إِنَّ الْعِوَجْ فِي الْمَعَانِ كَالْعُوجْ فِي الْأَعْيَانِ وَنَفْيُ الْعِوَجِ عَنِ الْقُرْآنِ لَهُ عِدَّةُ أَوْجَهٍ مِنْهَا. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the Quran has no iwaj in it, these are the meanings but that's meant by it. Awalan, nafyu tanaqud. When we say the Quran is not, iwajaj is not in it, meaning the Quran does not contradict itself. First understand that. Qala ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا. Do you not ponder on the Quran? If it was from anywhere other than Allah, you would have found in it contradiction. So Quran is not irwijah, it's mustaqim. When something is clear, it doesn't contradict itself. صح? It doesn't contradict itself. Number two, أَنَّ كُلُّ مَا ذَكَرَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى فِي الْقُرْآنِ مِنْ تَوْحِيدِ وَالنُّبُوَّةِ وَالْأَحْكَامِ وَالتَّكَالِيفُ فَهُوَ حَقٌّ وَصِدْقٌ وَلَا خَلَلَ فِيهِ. Everything Allah mentioned in it, when we say that the Quran has no irwijah فيه, we also mean that everything of it is true. There's no falsehood in it. Because when a person... When you want to say, Akhi, I don't like that person, why? Because he keeps diverting too much. Meaning he's lying. So a person, when he lies, he has to change the story. Sort this one out again. He has to keep going off the path, صح? Quran is not like that. قال تعالى, قرآناً عربياً غير ذي عوج. Mufassirin, they said, غير ذي عوج. عوج means, أي صدق في الأخبار وعدل في الأحكام. Sidqun fil akhbari. It's true in its wordings, the rule, stories that he tells you, and it's just in the rulings that he gives you. Fair. If the Quran gives you a ruling, that is fair. Why not? This Quran, if it was read on, the mountains which are jamadat will perish or will trample to the ground, come to the earth. قال تعالى, Allah says in the Quran, لو أنزلنا. If we were to send هذا القرآن, this Quran, على جبل, on a mountain. Look how big a mountain is. And it's sad, والله, وللأسف الشديد, that this Quran, if it was sent on a mountain, the mountain will come to the earth and become that small, and your heart is more stronger than that mountain. Your قلب, is more worse. ثم قصت قلوبهم من بعد ذلك فهي كالحجار. قال تعالى, انظر. فهي كالحجار أو أشد قسوة لأن الحجار ليس في قسوة. We see it. If the Quran comes on it, it will go down on the earth like that. Pieces. نعم. قال تعالى خاشعا متصدعا من خشية الله. Because he realizes the bigness and the might of these words. And you see a human being that walks there doesn't realize it. Or somebody who memorizes the Quran, who has it in his heart but it has no meaning to him. This Quran will also, the walls, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if the Quran was given to the wall or read to the wall will stop being a wall and it will come and it follow the Quran. قال تعالى, Allah says, وَلَوْ أَنَّ قُرْآنًا if the Quran سُيِّرَتْ بِهِ الْجِبَالُ أَوْ قُطِّعَتْ بِهِ الْأَرْضُ أَوْ كُلِّمَ بِهِ الْمَوْتَى. The Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, if this Quran, it was to happen, be brought on the mountains and the hills and the earth and the grounds and all of these things, you would have seen the mountains start moving, following it, obeying the Quran, and how big and immense it is. The dead will come out of their graves and start obeying it. What does that show you? How big and immense it is. Ikhwani, the Quran is sharaf. It's an honor. We're looking for honor. We have in the Quran honor. Three ayats in the Quran. Allah mentions that the Quran is an honor for us. Only three ayats. Qala ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, وَإِنَّهُ أَيْ الْقُرْآنِ لَذِكْرٌ لَكَ. It's dhikr, which we'll mention what it means. لَكَ for you, O Muhammad. وَلِقَوْمِكَ and your people. وَسَوْفَ and you. And they, تُسْأَلُونَ, they will be asked about this gift that they've been given. قَالَ الْإِمَامُ الْقُرْطُبِي رَحِيمُ اللَّهِ, he says, يَعْنِي الْقُرْآنُ شَرَفٌ لَكَ وَلِقَوْمِكَ مِنْ قُرَيْشٍ إِذْ نَزَّلَ بِلُغَتِهِمْ وَعَلَى رَجُلٍ مِّنْهُمْ. This Qur'an is a sharaf, first of all, to Quraysh, no doubt. It's a sharaf to Quraysh and Arabs, because first it came in their language. And the man was from them. They have sharaf khas. And the ummah, all of it, sharaf am. We come under the am. Which is, we follow him, salawatullahi wa salamun alayhi. The Qur'an is sharaf, honor for the ummah. Allah also says, لقد أنزلنا إليكم كتابا فيه ذكركم أفلا تعقلون, أي فيه شرفكم أفلا تعقلون. We have sent upon you a book, فيه in it is ذكركم, أي in it is شرفكم, your honor. أفلا تعقلون, are you not going to ponder? Are you not going to take a lesson from it? قال تعالى, this is the third ayah, صاد, الله أعلم بمرادي, والقرآن ذي الذكر. ذكر means, عبد الرحمن ناصر السعدي, he said, أي ذي القدرة عظيم والشرفة العالية. شرف in it for you. The Quran in it is شرف. للأسف الشديد, sadness. This Quran is your شرف. You see people looking for شرف elsewhere. He's looking for honor elsewhere. He's looking for dignity elsewhere. This Quran, before I mention that story that happened at the time of Umar ibn Khattab, Umar made one man a governor, a wali. When he made him a governor, wali, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Umar ibn Khattab, he wanted to go and visit that land that he made the man the wali. When the man heard that Abdul Umar ibn Khattab was about to come, he went to a place called outside the outskirts of the village, the town, the place that he was governor of. It was Usfan where he met him. When he met him, Umar said to him, can I ask you a question? If you came to visit, if you came to meet me outside the village, outside the place, I mean, I came to see you, and now you came out of where you were, your kingdom, your rulership, and you came outside to meet me, who is looking after the people? Who did he leave the people with? He said, Mawlali, a slave of mine. One of my slaves is looking after them. Umar, atajab. Mawlan, a slave, yahkumul ahrar, is going to govern free people. He said, Na'am ya Umar, innahu hafidha al-Qur'an. He memorized the Qur'an, wa'allam al-fara'id. And he knows the inheritance. He knows ilm al-fara'id. Umar then looked at him, he said, Asabt. Good, you got it right. فَإِنِّي سَمِعْتُ نَبِيَّكُمْ يَقُولُ, I heard your prophet say, صَلَوَاتُ اللَّهِ وَسَلَامٌ عَلَيْهِ, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَرْفَعُ بِهَذَا الْقُرْآنِ أَقْوَامًا. Allah lifts through the people this Qur'an. Lift, sharaf, makan. He was a slave yesterday. Today he's a real leader. He's leading Arabs, Quraysh, in Mecca. The place that Umar made him a governor was Mecca. He was governing him then in Mecca, a slave man. Who was slave, now he's free like him. But he used to be a slave. But when he memorized the Quran, Allah, what did he give him? That daraja. And remember, Arabs were too rich, were too arrogant to ever let anyone who's black or anyone who is a slave to rule them. That's how they were like. But they accepted it because they realized he had something big, which is the kitab of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Ata ibn Abi Rabah sat in the Kaaba for years. He was the student of Abdullah ibn Abbas. Wa kana mawlan, he was a slave. That was freed. Rather, he was black slave freed. He sat in the Kaaba, he used to give fatwa. Salman ibn Abdul Aziz used to come and listen to his fatwas. And used to ask him questions. Quraysh used to come. And they used to ask him questions. Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala, he was from al-Ard al-Bukhara, Uzbekistan, now is known as. Imam Muslim, he was from Naysabur, Ard al-Khurasan. Al-Imam al-Tirmidh, Tirmidhi was from Ard al-Tirmidh. Al-Imam ibn Majah was from min Bani Qazwini. Al-Imam al-Nasa'i, he was from min Bani Nasa. None of them were Arabs, all the six Ummahat al-Sittah, none of them were. Lakin saru mada, a'lam, they became leaders, commanders, because limada, we had a deen with this religion. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala lift your status up. Or else you will die not being known. You will be not having no sharaf. Al-Qur'an yahdi lillati hi aqwam. The Qur'an guides to the best. Anyone who looks in the Qur'an guidance, he will always find guidance in it. If he looks with it with eye sincerity. Other books, if you look for it, it might make you get lost. Advice of people might get you lost. The Qur'an never. Look what Allah says. Inna hadha al-Qur'ani يهدي للتي هي أقوم. This Quran guides you to the best. أقوم. ما معنى أقوم؟ في الدنيا, everything in this world matters. You want to do something in this world? Look in it for in the Quran. Solution in the Quran. You'll be successful. Trust me. Look what عبد الرحمن ناصر السعدي محمد أمين الشنقيطي said in his كتاب أضواء البيان. He says ذكر جل وعلا في هذه الآية الكريمة أن هذا القرآن العظيم الذي هو أعظم الكتب السماوية وأجمعها لجميع العلوم وآخرها عهدا برب العالمين جل وعلا يهدي للتي هي أقوى, أي يهدي إلى طريقة التي هي أشد وأعدل وأصوب الطريق. This Quran is the one that guides to the path that is the most looked after, curved, cleared, perfected path. Anyone who takes it from the Quran. Then the Shaykh says وهذه الآية قاعدة, which is عظيمة. هذه الآية العظيمة أجمل الله عز وجل فيها جميع ما في القرآن من الهدى إلى الخير الطرق وعدلها وأصوبها. In this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentioned to us in a concise way that if you're looking for guidance in all of its forms and you want to get to a place where you want to achieve something, don't look far, right under your nose. Get the Qur'an of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, study it. I remember my father told me that Muhammad Amin al-Shanqiti rahimahullah ta'ala, sahibu kitab al-adwa al-bayan, he sat in the Kaaba one day, ba'da salat al-asr, ba'da salat al-maghrib. He used to sit after salat al-maghrib, ila salat al-isha, he used to give tafsir. My father told me that one day he sat, he was giving tafsir, and he was explaining the ayah, وَلَا تُفْسِدُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ بَعْدَ إِصْلَاحِهَا. And the Shaykh sat down, and he gave the tafsir of this ayah, and he was on this ayah, and he did not go off topic until Salatul Isha came. And he was only talking about that one ayah. And the next day he came, he sat again, and then he started from the beginning of the ayah. And he explained it in a form different from the way he explained it yesterday. And then Isha was 7 days, he was explaining, وَلَا تُفْسِدُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ بَعْدَ إِصْلَاحِهَا. On the eighth day, he sat down and he tried to explain it. He couldn't explain it because the Shaykh cried, إِلَّا صَلَاتُ الْعِشَىٰ, he was crying. From Maghrib to Isha, he was crying when he was trying to explain it. It was a ummah, people, when you look at, who really recognize the azam and the makan of the Qur'an. Muhammad Amin al-Shanqiti was a alim of lugha. أي فن, any field he spoke about, حَامِلُ لِوَائِهَا, he was the leader of it. And my father said, we asked him one day as students, why did you want to choose the Qur'an? Why did you choose tafsir of the Qur'an? Why did you choose ulum al-hadith, مثلا? Why especially the Qur'an? Do you have a reason? He said, لِمَ لَا شَرَفُ الْعِلْمِ بِشَرَفِ مَعْلُومِ. Something is honored through when you see what you're studying. What is honoring? You will honor my words if I'm an honorable person. If I'm somebody who means something to you, my words mean something to you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is what his words are, what he is. وَلِمَ لَا, why would I not sit down and study it and teach it? And the Shaykh rahimahullah died and he was doing the tafsir of the Qur'an every single day. He finished it more than 30 times. القرآن كتاب مبارك. The Qur'an is mubarak. Allah mentions only 4 places in the Qur'an that the Qur'an is mubarak. He tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, وَهَذَا كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ مُبَارَكٌ مُصَدِّقُ الَّذِي بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ وَقَوْلِهِ تَعَالَى وَهَذَا كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ مُبَارَكٌ فَاتَّبِعُوهُ وَاتَّقُوا لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ وَقَوْلِهِ تَعَالَى وَهَذَا ذِكْرٌ مُبَارَكٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ أَفَأَنتُمْ لَهُ مُنْكِرُونَ وَقَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى كتاب أنزلناه إليك مبارك ليدبروا آياتي وليتذكر أولو الألباب. إخواني, last but not least, the individual who memorized the Quran, and nowadays, wallahi, people are very lazy for memorizing the Kitab of Allah. They love to find the quickest route. The quickest route. You say to me, it's not wajib to memorize the Quran. أخي فاتك شيء عظيم, something big has passed you. Kitab of Allah that you don't have in your heart, you've lost that something very big. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has a ahl, a people. Allah has a family on this earth, tabarak wa ta'ala, as He mentioned. In the hadith of Anas ibn Malik, in the hadith of Sunan ibn Majah, that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Inna lillahi ahleen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has ahl, families on this earth. Min al-nasi, from the people. Qalu ya Rasulallah, who are these people? Man hum? Qala, hum ahlul Qur'an. They are the people of the Qur'an. Ahlullah, they are the people of Allah. Wa khasatu, and they're specifically His. These are the people. They are ahlu of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. The word, إِنَّ لِلَّهِ أَهْلِينَ. Some people think أهلين is جمع ذكر سالم. ليس جمع ذكر سالم. إنه ملحق بجمع ذكر سالم منصوب لأنه اسم إن مؤخر. لأنه اسم إن مؤخر. And this hadith is, I think, is the most phenomenal hadith I came across. Or these two hadiths. The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم said, on the authority of موسى الأشعري, that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم said, إِنَّ مِنْ إِجْلَالِ اللَّهِ, one of the ways of honoring Allah. You want to honor Allah? Okay. Honor these three people. When you honor, if you want to honor Allah, you have to honor these three people. What's the first one? Ikram with the shayb al-Muslim. The Muslim man or woman who became old in Islam and her hair or his hair became white. Karim. Honor that person. They come in, hold them by the hand. Support them. Innahu min ijlalillah, is honoring Allah. See, an old person with white hair, man or woman, and they've become old through Islam, they deserve a lot of haqq. That honoring them is honoring Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. If you would have done that for someone, for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honoring, then honor this individual. وَحَامِلُ الْقُرْآنِ, and the one who carries the Qur'an, غَيْرَ الْغَالِ, that doesn't go overboard with it, فِيهِ وَالْجَافِي عَنْهُ, and the one that doesn't shortcome on it. He acts upon it basically. He carries the Quran and he acts upon the Quran. You know, min ijlalillah is honoring Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Wa ikrami this sultani, and is to honor the leader of the Muslim, al muqsid, that is just. The Muslim ruler that is just. It's fair to the people. Honor him by the just that he's done for you. Rawahu Abu Dawood wa hassanahu al-allamatu al-albaniyu. Fi sahih sunan Abi Dawood. The Qur'an, whoever carries the Qur'an and he memorizes the Qur'an, hellfire will not burn him. On the authority of the Sahabi al-Jalil, عُقْبَةَ مْنُ عَامِرٍ رضي الله تعالى عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لو كان القرآن في إهاب ما أكلته النار. The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم is telling us that if the Qur'an was in an إهاب, the hellfire will not dare to eat it. Meaning the Qur'an will never eat somebody in which the Qur'an is in his chest, in his heart, in his stomach. The Qur'an will never touch him. The hellfire will not touch him. لماذا؟ كلام الله في صدري. إخواني, the person who memorizes the kitab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he can be referred to as a person of knowledge. قال تعالى, بل هو آيات بينات في صدور الذين أوتوا العلم. It's ayat that have been compiled in the hearts of the people of knowledge. A person who has the Qur'an and he understands the Qur'an, he's a person of knowledge. أَسْأَلُ اللَّهَ تَبَارَكَ وَتَعَالَى رَبُّ الْعَرْشِ الْعَظِيمِ أَنْ يَجْعَلَنَا مِنْ أَهْلِ الْقُرْآنِ أَهْلُهُ وَخَاصَّتُهُ. هذا وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا ونبينا محمد وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين.